God's blessings to you and welcome to worship. And when I say welcome to worship, I mean that through the gift of the Holy Spirit in your house or in the gift of the Holy Spirit in your work, wherever you are worshiping, you are joining with us. And we are here for one reason, with no exceptions, and that is to praise the name of a living God. Would you all agree with that? And so we're going to get after that right after we have our invocation. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We're here to celebrate a living God today, and we're going to do that with the topic of All Saints Day. And All Saints Day is a day in the church year in which we give thanks to God for all the people that have gone before us in faith. All the people that we can think about and all the people that we can remember that have loved our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, that have been saved by the grace of Jesus Christ and are already in heaven with Jesus Christ. And so we celebrate that. I want to make it clear we are not praying to them. I want to make it clear that we are not doing anything but thanking God for the gifts of those people in our lives. And so we celebrate All Saints Day today, and we're going to do that a little bit differently in worship. We're going to have a couple worship songs about a portion of All Saints Day after a brief message, and then we're going to have another portion of songs of praise about All Saints Day after a brief message. And we hope, we pray that you enjoy this worship. We pray that in your houses you contribute to worship. We pray that in your houses you take ownership of this worship and you are participatory. And we also are hopeful that you'll share this worship experience with other people. One of the things that we do is that since we believe the same things as Christians, we make known what God has put on our head and our hearts through the gift of the Holy Spirit. One of the ways that we do that is we share words of a creed. And this isn't a prayer. This isn't anything along those lines. This is a statement of faith. This is a statement that when the devil comes knocking on our door and we're being tempted, we know what we can go through in our heads to take us back to what we believe. And we also know the people that say it with us. So if any one of you faces a struggle, or when I face a struggle, I can go to the people that I say this with, knowing that they have the same God and that they are going to give me Christ-like advice in Christ-like direction, bringing truth into my life. And so I ask that you join us in saying the creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. And now you have an opportunity to say the word Amen. And when you say Amen, you're agreeing to the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit, and you're also agreeing to where you fit into it as part of the church. Amen. Let's worship.
Is our God, a bulwark never fading, a helper he amid the flood, a mortal ills prevailing. We're still our ancient foe that seek to work us woe. His craft and power are great, and armed with cruel hate. On earth is not his easy. Oh, 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 oh. If we in our own strength confide, our striving would be losing. ask who that may be. Christ Jesus, it is He, the Lord of hosts, His name, from age to age the same. And He must win the battle.
Calm your heads, calm your hearts, center your heads, center your hearts, and let's go to our God together in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we have a living God, and sometimes we take that for granted. As we just sang about, if it would be us doing this, Lord, it would be failure. But because of the gift of Jesus Christ and because of the gift of His Holy Spirit in us, Lord, it is a win for You. And I ask, Lord, that You never let us get confused. And I ask, Lord, that You never let us wander. And I ask, Lord, that You never let us stray. And I ask, Lord, that You never let us think it's about us. But, Lord, let us remember always the gift of Your Spirit. I ask, Lord, that You would direct our eyes, the eyes of the church, to You, our Creator and our Maker, that we would know that we are loved by You at great cost. I ask, Lord, that as we have a chance to be in Your Word, that You would open our heads and that You would open our hearts and that Your Word would change our lives. I ask, Lord, that the praise that we give You would be heartfelt and the praise would be acceptable to You and that, Lord, You would find joy in it. All this we ask in Your most precious and holy name. Amen. The church has not always done an exceptional job. And when I say the church, I don't mean the invisible church. I don't mean the church that has gone on ahead of us, the church that has already passed on and is already with our Lord. I mean us as church leaders. I think I have conversations quite regularly with people as they come to Christ. Either they come to Christ as older individuals or they come to Christ in a realm where the Holy Spirit, for lack of better terms, has been awakened in them from something they've experienced in their life recently. And one of the things that almost always comes up is this discussion piece of, well, if I'm a Christian and I'm a part of the church, why is my life going like this? Why are these things happening to me? Why is this still something from my past that I can't escape? Why is this a struggle that I feel like I still have? Why is it that my kids don't talk to me? Why is it that my spouse did this to me? Or how could I have done this to my spouse? And we have these discussions all the time as pastors with people. And if you have those and you feel that way, it's perfectly acceptable. And it's normal. And I want you to continue as Christian individuals to come and talk to people. But I think that we've set people up for this idea that once you're a part of the church, once you know Jesus, everything in life becomes very easy. And I know that's not true for me. I know that's not true for the people that fill my house. I know that's not true for the people that I work with here at church. I know that's not true for the people that I counsel or the different things that I see on TV. And we forget this part that there's still warfare going on here on earth. We forget this part that the devil still prowls around like a roaring lion, seeking to devour all of those that believe in Jesus Christ. If you have your Bible, I encourage you to turn to Revelation chapter 12. And in Revelation chapter 12, we're going to look at just a few verses in this, and then we're going to talk about some of these challenges. Then we're going to sing about some of these challenges, and we're going to ask for God's direction in our life on them. I want you to envision this warfare. Revelation chapter 12, starting in verse 7. Now war arose in heaven. Michael and his angels fighting against the dragon. And the dragon and his angels fought back. But he was defeated, and there was no longer any place for them in heaven. And the serpent and the great dragon was thrown down, that ancient serpent who is called the devil and Satan, the deceiver of the world. He was thrown down to the earth, and his angels were thrown down with him. So there's this battle in heaven, and the devil realizes he's going to lose, and God takes him, and he throws him down here to earth. I'm going to skip ahead just a few verses to verse 11. And they have conquered him by the blood of the Lamb and the word of their testimony. And when we hear that they conquered him, we get really lax, and we think, well, as Christians, if the devil's already had his mouth closed and the devil's already lost his power, we should have nothing to fret. But you got to stay in the scripture. Jump to verse 13. And when the dragon saw that he had been thrown down to the earth, he pursued the woman who had given birth to the male child. So when the devil got thrown down, he sought Mary and he sought Jesus. And then I'm going to skip to verse 17. Then the dragon became furious with the woman, and he went off to make war on the rest of her offspring, on those who keep the commandments of God and hold to the testimony of Jesus. So if you've read the book of Revelation, the Revelation, you understand that the devil currently is waging war on us. While Jesus Christ is going to conquer death and the devil, and he's taking care of the death and the devil, we're not there yet. As we walk around this earth, guess what? Cancer is going to prowl around. And as we walk this earth, divorce is going to prowl around. And as we walk this earth, you're going to have conversations with young men, and you're going to ask them about their dad, and they're going to tell you their dads are in jail and they don't know where they are, and your heart is going to break. And when you walk this earth, you're going to spend time with kids, you're going to find out there's kids that don't have a good education, and those kids can't communicate properly, and they're not going to get the jobs. We talked about this in church or as a faculty this morning. One woman brought up the fact of human trafficking and what it does to her heart and what it does to her soul. The battle is real and the battle goes on. And when you walk this earth, even as Christians, you still can sometimes become overcommitted and you can wander away from Jesus Christ. If you think that the book of Revelation is far-fetched, I want you to turn to Ephesians chapter 6. And here you have Paul talking a little bit clearer about this battle. Ephesians chapter 6. Finally, be strong in the Lord and in the strength of his might. And I wish Paul would have ended right there, but he says, put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the schemes of the devil. For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the cosmic powers over this present darkness, against the spiritual forces of evil in heavenly places. Therefore, take up the whole armor of God that you may be able to withstand in the evil day and have done all to stand firm. And then Paul goes on, and I know it's a very familiar piece of scripture, but he talks about all this weaponry that we have as Christians as we fight these battles. He talks about all this weaponry that we have, and some of them are offensive weapons, and some of those are times that we just sit back because of what's going on in our lives, and we're just on a stance of defense. I don't know what you're going through. I I don't know what you've been through. In fact, I can't even promise you that other than the fact that the love of Jesus Christ will never be separated from you, I don't know what you're going to walk into someday in the future. I do know that the devil prowls around like a roaring lion, and I can look back at the Old Testament, and I can see that God has taken the mouths of lions when they were in the same pit as Daniel, and he closed them. I can look at different things like natural disasters all around Noah, and God saving Noah through just wood and through just a boat. I can look at different things like David, who stands up and he fights a giant. But for all of those individuals, the threat was real. For all of those individuals, they feared for their life. For all of those individuals, everything going on around them felt like it was overpowering them. We're going to have a chance to sing about this after we pray. And we're going to sing a song called Always. And then we're going to sing about fighting my battles and how the Lord is going to do that for you. I ask that you calm your head and you calm your heart, and that we pray, and then I ask that you can meditate on that song and sing with the praise team on that song. Dear Heavenly Father, each and every one of us has sins that we battle. Each and every one of us has seen broken relationships. Each and every one of us comes from families, and when we come from families, Lord, there's hurt. Lord, there's hurt in our world. There's injustice in our world. Sometimes, Lord, there's even pain in our hearts. Even though we know you, and even though we believe in you, and even though you have saved us, Lord, we still battle that. I ask, Lord, that as we lift up a couple songs of praise, that you would use those songs to fill us with your Spirit, that you would use those songs to encourage us, and that you would use those songs to fix our eyes upon you. So hear us as we praise you, Lord. Amen.
Thank you.
how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. This is how I fight my battle. This is how I fight my battles. 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 It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm this is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles.
Come on, lift them up.
This is how I fight my battles. 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 It may look like
started off in the first set about one of the things that the church hasn't done well. It hasn't prepared people to understand that even as Christians, you're going to face troubles that are going to feel overwhelming at times. One of the things the church has done extremely well is helping us all to lift our eyes past this world. This next section of scripture does just a wonderful job at pointing us to no longer the struggles of being a Christian, but the triumph of being a Christian. It takes us past the point of all the things that can discourage us as the devil prowls around, to a point when sin is no longer in the picture at all, and we are doing what we have been created by God to do. I ask that you open up your Bible to the last book, to Revelation. And in the book of Revelation, chapter 7. In Revelation chapter 7, I'm going to read. And then after I read a little bit, we're going to talk about it very briefly. And then we are going to sing some songs of praise about the triumph that God has got in our future. So Revelation chapter 7, starting in verse 9. After this I looked, and behold, a great multitude that no one could number, from every nation, from all tribes and peoples and languages, standing before the throne and before the Lamb, clothed in white robes with palm branches in their hands. A couple things I want to point out from that. Do you see the diverse nature of the church? Every nation, every tribe, every tongue, all peoples, in a number so great that you never have to worry about it filling up. And they're standing before the throne, and they're praising God, and they're robed in white robes. They're robed in God's righteousness, Christ's righteousness to be more exact. And one of the things I like about this section of this picture of heaven is that John sees people for the first time the way that Jesus sees them. John sees people for the first time the way that God sees them. He doesn't mention anything about the fact of who they are or their past or the mistakes they've made. All he mentions is that they're robed in the Christ, in the righteousness of Jesus Christ. And we believe that as a church, that the minute you're baptized, you're killed and you're made new, and you're made new as one, as part of the body of Christ. And that's how John's eyes are opened in this picture of heaven. That's just remarkable for All Saints Day. And then what you see them doing, you think back to Paul in Ephesians, and he's talking about swords and he's talking about shields and he's talking about all these weapons that are going to keep their hands busy as they're in this church militant or this church fighting stage as we fight the devil. And at this point in Scripture, you see their hands filled with something else. You see their hands filled with what? Palm branches. And these palm branches are this tool to bring praise to a living God. What a beautiful time in history, or future history, when we're going to be able to lay down all of these things that we need to protect ourselves or to find our identity. And we're going to be able to lay those down. We're going to pick up a simple thing. We're not going to have a cross anymore, but we're going to have palm branches of praise. Let's look at heaven a little bit clearer. And as they're holding these palm branches in verse 10, they're crying out with a loud voice, "Salvation belongs to God who sits on the throne and to the Lamb." And all the angels were standing around the throne and around the elders and the four living creatures, and they fell on their faces before the throne and worshiped God, saying, "Amen. Blessing and glory and wisdom and thanksgiving and honor and power and might be to our God forever and ever. Amen." Then one of the elders addressed me, saying, "Who are these clothed in white robes, and from where have they come?" I said to him, "Sir, you know." And he said to me, "These are the ones coming out of the great tribulation. Those are the ones that were tested by the devil. Those are the ones that were on earth and were being persecuted." And it says, "They have washed the robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb, in the blood of Christ Jesus our Lord." I see this picture of heaven, and my heart is opened over the fact that they see each other like God sees them. No judgment, no junk, no garbage, no oppression, no sin, none of those things that hurt. I see that picture of heaven, and I see a couple things. I see a Pastor Rasmussen there with his mom, and I see them praising their Lord together. I don't know if they're standing next to each other. I don't have to know. I just know that they're there. I see a man like Martin Luther King who was trying so hard to reform. And guess what? He's not worried about his life anymore. He's got his kids with him. Like, that's a great thing to see. I see a man like my best friend that died holding his 3.5-year-old daughter, and they're doing what they were created by God to do. The same thing that you'll be doing, the same thing that you'll be doing, the same thing that I'll be doing, and the same thing that you'll be doing. You've been created by God to praise your Lord. And that's what they're going to be doing. And there's not going to be sin to worry about, and there's not going to be payments to worry about, and there's not going to be any one of these future things to worry about other than what fills you being made by God. And so we're going to pray, and then guess what we're going to do? We're going to sing three songs. We're going to sing, the first and foremost is one of my favorites called Raise a Hallelujah. To God alone be praised. And how many hallelujahs? 1,000, right? Unlimited. So let's pray, and then let's get after that praising God for what he's up to. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we come here to give you thanks. We come here to give you thanks, Lord, for what you've done for us in our baptism, for what you've done for us in the Holy Spirit, for what you do in us with the people that surround us, how you work in our lives. I ask, Lord, that like it says in Revelation chapter 2, verse 10, that you keep us strong in our faith even unto death, at which point we receive the crown of life. I ask that you use that future to inspire us, that you remind us, Lord, that we have been given an opportunity to praise you. And so I ask that the praise be heartfelt. All this we ask in your most precious and holy name. Amen. Let's raise a hallelujah together.
Presence of my enemy, I raise.
sing a little louder.
Oh, sing a little louder.
Sing a little louder.
In the presence of my enemies.
Sing a little louder.
Louder than the unbelief.
Sing a little louder.
My weapon is a melody.
Sing a little louder.
Heaven comes to fight for me.
Sing a little louder. In the presence of my enemies. Sing a little louder. Louder than the unbelief. Sing a little louder.
My heaven is a melody.
Sing a little louder. Heaven comes to fight for me. Seated above, throned in the Father's lap, destined to die, poured out for all mankind. God's only Son, perfect and spotless one. He never sinned or suffered as if he did. Overcome. We will He has overcome the grave. He is giver of every breath and author of all authority. We give him our praise because it's all because of Jesus that we are alive. Giver of every breath I breathe, author of all eternity, giver of every perfect thing, to you be the glory. Maker of heaven and earth, no one can comprehend your word. King over all the universe, to you be the glory.
Offering is placed in worship. I love the fact that we give out a response to being loved first, that it comes heartfelt praise and all those other things, and it comes from having our eyes lifted to what God's going to do, and then we get to this point where we can respond in a generous act to God. And we have done that in our songs, we have done that in learning, in the Word of God, and now we have a chance to do that also in finances as well. We also have a chance to do that by loving our neighbor as we love ourselves. So I encourage you, however you give an offering, if you give online, to go ahead and do that. Or if you write a check to send in the church, or the church is unlocked on your normal business days to be able to bring it in. But however you do it, my only request, or actually it's a command, is that you do it with a good heart. You know, if there's misgiving in it, or if there's mistrust in it, or if there's junk that fills you, just don't give. It's absolutely okay. We give to God with a good heart. Because we've been loved, we have an opportunity to not only love other people, but to love our Lord and expand his kingdom. And so that's one of the ways that we do that. I want to give you your blessing, and here's your blessing. And some of you might remember your baptism, some of you might not. I hope you've all been able to witness a real-life baptism in the sanctuary or here in chapel. But the name of the Father, the name of the Son, and the name of the Holy Spirit was set over the top of you. And then it was finished with, may God who began this good work in you. You can either imagine the baby there, or you can imagine the adult. May God who began this good work in you see it through until the day of his completion. And that day of his completion is either going to be when the Lord returns, or the day that you get that crown of eternal life upon your death. And so I want to give you that blessing to keep you strong and to let you know what's been said over you earlier. In the name of the Father, and in the name of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, may God who began this good work in you see it through until the day of his completion. And all God's people say, amen. God bless you. Have a great week. Go and serve the Lord by showing love to other people. Is that fair? Amen. Have a great week.